Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Okay, so we can get started. Good morning, everybody. Welcome to Project Trident Scientific Workbench tutorial. I'm Dean Guo. I'm a senior program manager for responsible for the Trident development. And today we have three presenters. I'm going to present first to just introduce what Trident background is, and then we're going to start with demos. Yan Xu is going to demo the astronomy scenario, and Keith Groucho is going to demo a scenario from oceanography. So after the demos, I'm going to deep dive the Trident features. And we also have a handout, so you don't need to write down all the steps. In the handout has all the steps needed for today's demo. For Trident, the design philosophy of Trident is we want to leverage Windows Workflow Foundation. Windows Workflow Foundation is part of that .NET framework, and there is a separate team within Microsoft. It's a couple of hundred people. They are dedicated to the development, continuing innovation of the workflow engine. We only added the features that are required. For example, we added the interface to high-performance computing cluster, the scheduler. We also added the provenance, and we added the custom designer, so it's easier for scientists to use. And we want to make the platform extensible. What that means is you can develop custom services, and you can custom your UI and leverage the workflow. Excuse me. And we also want to integrate with community tools. For example, we can leverage the My Experiment website, and we can export workflows to My Experiment, and users can share workflows. And so you can go to My Experiment website and download the or workflows and use it in Trident. These are some of the requirements we collected during the development. For example, scientists want to visualize ocean processes and share analysis. What that means is they want to visualize the workflow, and they want to easily share with other scientists. And they want to repeat the experiments. So research reproducibility is very important. Also, they want to try different parameters and run different models. And so they want to share workflows, and they want provenance. And for example, John really wants to know my results to drive this model, and want to share with workflow with share my workflow and the executables. So this is our understanding of scientific workflow. Composition goes through many iterations. That means users want to try different parameters, and they want to run workflow with different models, and they can easily reconfigure it. A lot of researchers, they use scripts, and that works. But a lot of times, if you want to plug in a different model and you have to modify the script, it may take a long time. And in Trident, we want to make sure this process is easy. You can easily unplug a algorithm or model and then plug a new one. And data flow is very important. So we allow users to easily define inputs, outputs, and connect inputs and outputs within a designer. Of course, we want to make it easy to publish and share workflows. And provenance is very important. We provide automatic provenance capture during runtime. And we capture the intermediate results. We also preserve the version of the workflow the user used at that time. And let's say you modify the workflow and you want to go back to the original workflow, you can easily go back. And then you can also keep track of the version evolution. And of course, we want to be adaptable to different computing environments. Some users want to use a desktop environment, and some users have data intensive calculations, and they want to use clusters. So we want to make it a uniform experience. So you can run workflows on the desktop. Also, you can run workflows in the high performance clustering environment. So these are the high level Trident project objectives. We want to demonstrate that a commercial workflow engine can be used to implement scientific workflow. I think this is the first system that leverages the commercial engine, the workflow foundation, and then build on top of that and support the scientific workflow. And we want to offer this system as an open source accelerator, so you write once and you can deploy on a desktop, and then you can deploy in the high performance cluster environment. Of course, we have automatic provenance capture. And out of the box, Trident supports SQL Server, but it's not limited to SQL Server. The architecture supports other database technologies. Also, we make sure it's easy to migrate to cloud storage. And reproducible research is a very important goal for Trident. So we record intermediate results. We record the workflows. We also have a Word add-in so that you can run workflows within Microsoft Word, and then you can capture the inputs and output, and then you can actually embed the workflow package within Word, and then you can share with other researchers. So there are different ways of sharing workflows and record what you did, and then go back to find out what the workflow was. Because the most important thing is we want to make sure when we develop the Trident workbench, we use the real customer scenarios. We use the real e-science projects as a basis, as a foundation for requirements and continuous improvements. Trident has been released as a binary form. This is the, if you go to this website, you can see all the materials about Trident, and you can download the binary today. Within a week, we're going to release another binary. Actually, we're about ready to release a version 1. It's really will be more robust. The first binary release was in January. That's during the Microsoft Research Faculty Summit. Since then, we have been fixing some bugs, and I believe right now we're at the stage, the system is fairly stable, and it's almost meet our bar for a version 1 release. So I'm confident by the end of the month, we should have one. And we also have a community site. This is where we're planning to post samples, and users can submit feature requests. And you can also send issues, and we can provide technical support. We're also planning for a other support mechanism, for example, blogs and other ways of so that we can have a uniform support mechanism from our team, because we have other projects in the pipeline, and we want to make this so we don't want users to go to different places to to find different products. We want to make it uniform. So we're in the process of doing that, and then we will keep you posted. Now I'm going to introduce Yan Xu, and she's going to start with the astronomy scenario.
Good morning, everyone. Oh, hey, back me up then if I make any mistake regarding astrophysics stuff. So my research at Microsoft focus on computing for the energy and earth and environmental science related. And what I'm going to do today is to walk you through a couple of Trident workflows that we built for astronomers. Actually, I want to do a little calibration before I go on. So how many of you here are professional astronomers? I better be careful. Two of them. Anyone consider yourself as an amateur astronomer? How amateur? They're very knowledgeable. I also have a great deal to learn from. So. And they're rich, actually. So when I was in China for the eclipse, so us professional astronomers only go to the locations that hope didn't rain. No, the weather is good at that. And there is a bunch of rich astronomers there on the airplane and chasing the eclipse. That's what they do. So I think although these scenarios that I'm about to present are designed specifically for astrophysics, but I think you will find many features in common in these workflows with whatever which field that you're working on in biology or physics or even chemistry. That's because I believe computing technology these days have fundamentally changed the way that we practice science. And that is especially true for astronomers. So astronomy used to be a very observational. Nowadays, it's becoming more experimental because not only they can capture what they observe in digital format, but also they can model and simulate what's yet to be discovered in the universe. But at the same time, that is very exciting, but at the same time, it could be overwhelming for astronomers because they are just buried, practically buried by data, a large, huge amount of data. The satellites, the telescopes in the space keeps running and pouring the data to astronomers, and they just need to figure out how to take advantage of all these data. A lot of astronomers that I met and then telling me that they sometimes found themselves being distracted by the computing part of it, and often the frustration comes from the limited computing power in their research lab. So what Trident can do for astronomy is that, number one, we think we can help them to automate the data process that they have to find themselves repeatedly doing. And number two, we can help them enable the so Trident actually enables existing tools plug in. So you don't have to know how to code. You can just connect all the tools that you need to use in Trident. And Trident also facilitates parallel computing in a high-performance environment. And most importantly, Trident provides a user-friendly interface. So let's look at some fairly straightforward cases. We know that NASA studies space. I didn't know before myself that they actually devote a lot of resources to study our home planet Earth. They have 18 satellites, keeps running and just to collect information about the Earth. And they have a set of, so they share the images they collected from these observations. Among those is a set of images called Blue Marble. These are the map of Earth, monthly map of the Earth, created from the satellite observation. So it shows the ice coverage and the vegetation change around the year. So these are, I can show you the website if I'm lucky enough to, no. So, but anyway, if anyone is interested, I can show you where to find these beautiful home true color images of the Earth. What I have here, what I'm going to show you is the monthly image of 2004. And this one in particular, I have it here, is October 2004 from NASA satellite observation. Each image like this is at a resolution of 20,000 pixel by 10,000 pixel. Now, when you look at the whole map of the Earth like that in two dimensions, you probably will wonder, oh, so this is the whole map of the Earth. Would be nice that if I can put on a globe view, a virtually three-dimensional, like this, and so that I can, let's see, so that I can zoom in, zoom out, and spin, and get into some areas I'm interested, and then perhaps animate the changes throughout the year. So then the question is, let's see, how do we go from a two-dimensional view to a three-dimensional, virtual three-dimensional view like that? And so from software engineering perspective, it's fairly straightforward. You take a two-dimensional image, you cut it off into small pieces, and then you wrap these pieces around a globe view. But then there are quite some work in terms of supporting different rate of zooming. So if you want to allow zooming and zoom out and spinning at the reasonable resolution, then you have to create a tree of tiles, what do we call, small pieces at different granularity. So each level of granularity of the tiles corresponds to different levels of zoom. So from an engineering perspective, that's what you need to do. And then once you have those tiles, you wrap around a three-dimensional view, and you need application that's capable of displaying a view like that. And Microsoft Research Worldwide Telescope can do that and more. And Worldwide Telescope is one of the most innovative applications from Microsoft Research. If any one of you are interested in that by yourself, please come to talk to me. Here, I'll just use it as the end application to show the results. What it does is that Worldwide Telescope enables your computer to function like a telescope. You can explore the universe, and you can browse through all the knowledge that the human have accumulated thus far about the universe. And it provides the 3D views of sky objects like I just showed you. It's a knowledge base. It connects with all the information with regard to other objects that we show in that system. And it is an XML-based tool so that it's very easy to integrate with other tools. For example, Galaxy Zoo is a citizen science project in astronomy. And Worldwide Telescope has a very nice integration made recently. And this is also, so Worldwide Telescope is also like Trident. It's free for non-commercial use. So now that's look at the data process of converting a two-dimensional image to a 3D view like what I just showed you. So first of all, we take those images, high-resolution images from NASA, and we put it on our system, our file system. And so within that nice file structure, what the first thing you need to do to tell a computer to do is to locate where the images are. And once you found those folders and you identify specific images that you want to process, namely with a given file extension, and then what you do is to generate some metadata regarding each of the images. So that the tools, whichever the tools you use from a vendor, from Microsoft, from other, knows how to read these images and to process as instructed. So that's as a good engineering practice, we use XML file to label the metadata of each image. And then once you have that, so we feed the images and the metadata XML to yet another Microsoft tool called Sphere Toaster. Sphere Toaster does is just do the tiles, create the tiles like I just described. It produces a tree of tiles and another XML describes the relationship among those tiles. And then we're ready to fit these images, the tiles, and the XML to the end application, which is the Worldwide Telescope. So to translate this whole image process pipeline into Trident, that's what you get. This view doesn't show much, so let me switch to Trident itself. So this is the workflow we build for what I just described. We started from getting a folder list, which is a nice utility in Trident. You give it the name of the folder, that's where I store. So here, this is the location that I have my image files on. And then you ask Trident to iterate through, use a replicator in Trident to iterate through all the folders and find all the files. So for each folder, we're doing a get file list Trident utility. And then once we've done that, we call a XML generator activity on each of the images. So we get the metadata created for each image. And then we can launch the Sphere Toaster, which will cut the two-dimensional images into pieces for each of the images we found. And at the end, I just want to sample how the tiles are produced. So I do a string comparison to find October 2004's image and then display it in Worldwide Telescope. So Worldwide Telescope as the end application is also launched from within Trident. So that's the workflow. Since the images are, the original image is so big, 20K by 10K, so I'm not going to run against those images today. Otherwise, it would take a month, actually, to process the whole set of the 12 months images. What I did is I created a scaled-down seasonal image for just the purpose of demonstration today. So I'll show you where I have astrophysics demos. So I have NASA Blue Marble. I have this scaled-down the images for each of the season. So what I'm going to do, I did a try run before, so I'm going to delete all the generated files, and then you can see how the Trident workflow works. So I got just the image, NASA images, scaled down NASA image for each of the season in October. Now, so these are all cleared out. As I run Trident workflow that I just showed you, it's going to generate the metadata XML and the tiles, the tree of tiles. So I'm going to just, from here, I'm going to run, So here, let me start a workflow. And Dean will give you more detailed demos of how to build drag and drop, actually, to build a workflow like I'm showing you right now. So now you see the status bar showing that we're running this workflow. And then gives you the monitor, Trident monitor, shows you step by step where you are at with regard to each steps of the workflow. And then if I come back here, so this is, it's generating the files for me, the tiles and the now thumbnails and all the intermediate XML. So when I run this in Rnet, I was going to say when I run this in my office, it was very fast, but I never failed. It's failing here. I don't know why. I have to run in my home office. Huh? Still going, looks like. But so if everything goes as I expected, now still running, I guess. Here, so it's actually, yeah. So since I did a low resolution, if you zoom in, it's quite fuzzy, this one, because I cut this scale from 20K to 540K. So if I processed the original image, and then this is what you get in the animated. Ah. So I'll show you the end result if I spend the whole month process the original. So then you put all these maps together throughout the month of 2004. You can see the changes of ice coverage and the greens. That's the end result that you can get from the workflow. So this block here from the two-dimensional panoramic, rather, images to a virtual three-dimensional display, this process is quite typical. Doesn't matter how you start with and which application you use to present. So we kind of built this block as a workflow template. People who use have a different starting point and end point can incorporate this portion of the workflow into their own workflow. And so we provide this as a template to many other, this plan is to provide it to many other use of astronomy pipelines. Now, that was about mapping the Earth. There is other projects, for example, Sloan Digital Sky Survey. This project is about mapping the universe. So this is where astronomers really find themselves being buried with data. It's such an ambitious sky survey project and produces huge amount of data. And it just pours these data to astronomers. And then everybody is just trying to figure out how exactly they can take advantage of these large amount of data to get information about the sky and to enable their astronomical research. So let me give you an example of a typical SDSS-based research. This is the scenario at the University of Washington. What these student project, this is a PhD student out there, his project is to take 600 spectra from the digital sky survey, and each of the spectra is in the 4,000 domain of wavelengths. And what he needs to do is the assumption is that they believe that all these spectra are mainly composed of several different sky objects that they can categorize or group into. What they wanted to do is to work out a group of weight factors associated with those main objects of the sky in the sky, and then do a simulation between that model and the raw spectrum by minimizing the difference between the two, the real data and the model. They can work out the weight factors, and then that gives them some categorization of the sky objects. So what they do is they repeatedly applying nearest neighbor reconstruction to the original spectrum to find the embedding weights for those categorization factors. And so they reconstruct the dimension transformation, and mainly involves matrix inversion and Fourier transformation in that process. I think it's very typical. I mean, all these things, disregard these are astronomical spectrum. When I was doing my PhD in magnetic resonance imaging, I pretty much go through the same kind of data process. And so that they can determine at this step, once they get all these matrix worked out, they can determine smallest eigenvalues. And the end result is the eigenvectors they're looking for. So they can group those large set of data sets into 1, 2, 3, 5 groups, and so on. So the challenge for them right now is, I mean, you can see the data process is quite fairly, I mean, straightforward. But unfortunately, this is not what they do in practice. The first step in practice, what they did is actually sample down the data to a dimension that their computing power allows them to process. So before they actually getting into their theory, they use nearest neighbor reconstruction just to average out some of the data so that they cut the dimension from 60,000 to 10,000, and then their computing power can handle that. So this is where it comes interesting to them, that not Triton, but also the high performance computing embedded before Triton can help them to start with the raw data and not to lose any information in their research process. So this is a work in progress, and we're trying to understand the workflows and understand what they need and help them to eliminate this part so that they can work directly from the raw sets of the spectrum and towards the end results. So the challenge is that, as you all know, most of the astronomers don't use Windows. So we're facing a cross-platform compliant issue right now. We're figuring out how to support, I mean, Triton are already supporting web service, which allows certain degree of cross-platform support. Right now, we're trying to figure out how to invoke tools from Windows workflow into some programs running directly on Linux. So that we're working on that. And then the second thing is that a lot of scientists, they use existing math libraries. In this case, University of Washington astronomers, they actually use a lot of matrix inversion subroutines found in Intel's math curl library. So we're trying to connect Triton with those widely used libraries. And then most importantly, Microsoft Research also has Dryad Link, which supports distributed computing. So we wanted to take this digital sky survey scenario as an example to help us understand and enable the integration between Triton and the distributed environment. So I believe that next year of this time, we should have very exciting results to report with regard the progress on this in this area. So having said that, I think I'll pass by to the next demo. Any questions about these workflows that I showed?
Have you done the Windows
workflow
already?
Yeah, it's just like yesterday we were doing that.
No, we and that 6 months ago.
Is it? Oh, okay then. Yeah, great. We must talk. Of course, yeah, our limitation is that we don't know Linux that well.
Yeah.
So then if you could help, really appreciate it.
Are there any issues with the scientific libraries and licensing? So I have a lot of biologists who want to use MATLAB, for example. MATLAB has an evil licensing model. Does the math kernel have a similar sort of thing, or have you had any experiences like that?
Actually, that's a really great question. So for us, even to use MATLAB or math kernel library on Microsoft campus, I have to get permission from legal. So what we do is integrate those. We only get license and the permission to integrate as a demo. So I integrate that and show it to you. You would have to get your own license
right. And
to do what, you know, or replicate what I show you. So that's how it works. So we do not plan to release any integration with Trident. What's that?
It's the Sphere Toaster utility.
Yes, it is. It's a free download. I can show you where it is.
Right.
Yes. Great. So I'll give it to Keith. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
So you've got it? Got it? Whoa. Hi, my name is Keith Grocco. I'm a PhD candidate at the University of Washington. I've been looking at a different set of problems. There's a lot of similarities, but I've been working with the oceanography world. And I'm going to show you some of the work we've been able to do with them, and looking ahead, how we plan on integrating TRIDE and what we've been able to accomplish so far, problems we've seen, things that are working pretty well for us. So the project I'm working on, doing my PhD work on, is kind of taking a user-centered approach to the data needs of the oceanography world. A big visionary at the beginning of this was Jim Gray. He saw some of the problems that e-scientists were having, in particular being able to look at many different types of data sets together easily, quickly, kind of put them in a context that made it easy to talk across a set of problems. The rest of the team, so there's me, there was Jim, Ed Lazowska at the University of Washington, Mark Stormer at the University of Washington, been the main people working on it. So COVE, which I'll show in a little bit, is an application that builds on kind of the virtual Earth, Google Earth model, and allows, kind of builds on the zoomability of it, the ease of bringing data into a common environment, and puts it out there so that these oceanographers that work in many different types of fields. So oceanography is a field or is an area of science that encompasses just about every other e-science or ocean or atmospheric science as well. And so putting all these in one place allowed them to kind of work across things much better. In particular, we've been out to sea a couple of times with COVE, and what this allows is you can bring in data quickly, do new planning kind of on the fly, and it's been used on both last year to do a bunch of mapping off the coast of Washington, and sorry it's going to be so static right now. I'll get to the demo later because I have to switch machines to do that. So bear with that. And this summer to go out and actually do a set of dives with Alvin down 2-3 miles off the coast of Washington in order to kind of track those dives and bring that data back and actually help the scientists understand where they've been. It's actually really tough to know where you've been at the bottom of the ocean. So science, oceanography to date has been a very expeditionary-based science. They've taken boats, they've gone out, they've collected some data, they brought it back. There's a lot of limits to doing science in this kind of way, and most other sciences have moved on. Oceanography is just going through this. One of the things that's going in, it was just funded by the NSF, is an observatory off the coast. Well, it's a global observatory. It's the Ocean Observatory Initiative. The part I've been working with is a deep water observatory off the coast of Washington. And so here is basically where the Columbia comes out. And so there'll be one set of nodes off there. And about halfway down, Oregon is another major connector. And the goal is to bring high bandwidth and power to the bottom of the ocean. That's the main limiter on being able to do in-place science down there. To date, all the data, everything you put down there, you have to somehow bring it back up, bring it back to land in order to get data out of it. And it's run on batteries. So with this kind of mechanism, you can put things in there for a long time and actually study process over time. Or, in the case of things like earthquakes, actually be there when they occur, as opposed to now where you go out a week later and hopefully there's still enough information or data there to do some science with. So with this observatory idea, this Jim Gray once again was a big push for this, was the idea of taking something like Trident and using it to go from the observatory, handle their data needs and provenance needs, use something like the visualization system I'll show you in a second, and be able to use this as a nice process for getting data to users. So I've been working mainly on the COVE piece, which I'll show in a second, and then the work going forward is kind of figuring out how we fit in Trident to this mechanism. And the research so far has been pretty promising. We've gotten another grant from the Ocean Observatory Initiative to do a set of prototypes to kind of help them figure out their design for the project. Okay, so now just if you'll excuse me for a minute, I'm going to have to switch machines. And it's a Mac running Windows on a new projector, so it could take a minute. Yeah, I'm not from Microsoft, so I'm allowed to use alien technology. Okay. I'll let you know in a minute if it's a good time to do a coffee run. Come on, baby. Yes. Okay. Not the best resolution, but it'll work. Stop it. Okay. Pretty familiar environment for those that have worked with Google Earth or Virtual Earth. Kind of a globe is a standard model. We've got a few different projections you can do. Basically, the idea with COVE was to look at something like Google Earth or Virtual Earth and figure out, how is this actually useful for scientists? It seems on the surface like it's been very popular elsewhere with scientists that should have a lot of value. What do you actually have to do to it to make it a value, at least in our case, to oceanographers, which is the group, scientific group we were working with? So let me just get this going. Okay, let that kind of run and tell the story as well. So what we did is basically built our own system, much like Google Earth or Virtual Earth. We found there were a lot of limitations in the existing source code, or the source code wasn't available. And by the way, this it's not available as open source yet, but the plan is to go that way, either through coordination with Trident or some other mechanism. So COVE is a makes it possible to look at satellite-based data sets, which is one of the needs in oceanography and, as we've seen, in other mechanisms. Come on. Yeah. But the other things we've been able to use it for is, first off, being able to help actually plan the observatory. So using the interface as an interactive mechanism, much like you would a drawing program, in order to quickly lay out where nodes should be, how much it costs to run cable to certain areas, bring up heads-up displays so the scientists can actually see the information they're going on as they're making the decisions. This actually replaced the old model, which was sitting around a table with a bunch of spreadsheets and maps and trying to figure it out. Then coming up with an idea, sending it off to a graphic staff, and getting it back 3 days later and hoping that it kind of looks like what you thought it did. So kind of, you know, what we expect from computers to bring to a process like this, this actually worked very well in that context. Which you also saw that went by pretty quickly. So I'll go back. Is the bottom of the ocean is actually pretty uninteresting, as it's a very interesting place. It's pretty uninteresting visually, given the images we have of it. All we have are things from about 10 feet away. You don't have the wonderful satellite pictures that you have everywhere else. So most places, it's just pictured blue and shaded. So we did quite a range of work helping to put in both the variety of terrain they collect, which is they have everything from the stuff you'll see in something like Google Earth now, which is the data points are about a mile apart, down to, in some cases, a meter apart, is some of the data we represent. And the other thing is being able to visualize that in some interesting ways. So being able to quickly do gradients and different color mechanisms that are familiar to the oceanographers so that they can quickly see exactly what they're looking for and get a lot more information out of the bottom of the ocean. And we're hoping this is something that other systems will integrate in to help the scientists. Okay. So that's kind of looking at the observatory and the terrain. And then the other area, of course, is the data that's collected and being able to visualize that in a more interesting way. Right now, you're pretty much limited in the current applications to, as was shown, being able to come up with a set of images, 2D images that look like the data. On the other hand, what you'd really like is 3D data that is animated and can be handled and visualized in many different ways. So this in particular is a earthquake swarm. It was in 1994 off the coast of Washington. So that's one of the data we spend quite a bit of time with, is seismology data. A lot of video is being collected from the bottom of the ocean. And so we've been working on how to do in-situ video that's been collected and be able to actually use this as a scientific resource as opposed to just right now a big collection of bits and kind of sit somewhere. Next one is looking at, now there's observed data, but the big data driver in oceanography is ocean models. And that unfortunately is going to hide that. There's a model back here. We'll see a little more of it later. But this is also looking at using Trident to kind of help us look at these data sets. But so it's basically looking at model data, which is the big data driver, comparing it to observed data, which is what they're collecting and actually want to compare it against and figure out if the models are working. And then using this to drive new hypotheses on how the ocean is actually working. So I think I've seen enough of that. Let's just do this again. And so this is a typical model of the, this would be in Monterey Bay, and we're looking at temperature. Any oceanographers in the room? Great. I get away with so much. Ah, because there's a quiz in this one. It's like, so as you would guess, you know, the red is the darker and or is warmer temperature, and the green is colder temperature. And the weird thing here is you would expect the warm temperature to be near the coast, and it's not. What you have is the cold water near the coast, which means that actually it's something that's very important to oceanographers. It's an upwelling event. It's saying that nutrients are coming up from the bottom and bringing cold water with it. So it's one of the things that they really look for and like to model and track that over time. Okay, so that's COVE. That's the work I've been doing. Once my advisor agrees, I'll get a PhD and move on. Okay, so what we did then is we looked at, we've got a bunch of work we've done with the oceanographers. We're starting to understand their needs. And now we really need to look at what they needed with regards to Trident or what they needed with regards to data. And the big problems that they had coming up were, A, that they had to be able to scale to immense sizes. The models that they're doing going forward are going to be for entire areas like the Puget Sound and, you know, 200 miles off the coast. And this is going to look like about 300 gigabytes a day. And also, let's see. So looking at, yes, scalability for large data sets, and also being able to track things as you're working with these data sets and knowing what changes you've made to tasks you're handling with them. Okay, so those are kind of the big drivers that made it seem like Trident would be a good fit for this. The downside, or the things that we had to figure out were, A, we had a bunch of legacy code we had to work with, and we had to see how we could get that in. B, we had to look at a multi-platform issue. So we've been the voice to Microsoft that sometimes their stuff is a little too .NET-centric for the rest of the world. And then finally, visualization as a something that can be handled in the cloud, meaning that right now visualization for most oceanographers or most scientists consists of bringing all your data locally, kind of playing with it and coming up with the visualization you like. That works great when it's a gig, maybe up to 5 gig. It doesn't work great when it's a terabyte. You have to start thinking about moving the visualization actually to the data. And so we've done a little bit of work there as well using Trident. So those are the three things I want to show. Okay, first thing, we'll go here. How are we doing for time, Dean? Okay. So once again, Dean's going to show this thing actually in motion. I just wanted to show you some of the bits we've done. So the first thing was kind of coming up with a set of activities that actually look like, and I'm apologize for the fact that each of these are going to be doubled. Little thing I'm working around right now. But basically trying to figure out the core set of activities given the processes we saw that would define what the oceanographer and what their workflows are, or what the components of their workflows will look like, and creating those activities. So there was about 50 activities that we created. As you would expect, a lot of them were converting data to get it in. Also, combining data sets, a lot of stuff we saw earlier, being able to make them smaller and actually pick out the bits you needed, do filtering. And then there's some visualization work that we'll show later. And then based on that, let's see, make that smaller again. And how do we fit it to the screen? That one? Can you all read that? Yeah. I know. just kind of give you a feel. Most of these are pretty... Oh, this thing that I didn't expect anyone. It was actually a joke. But anyway, a set of kind of 15, 20 workflows that we've been able to put together pretty easily based on these activities that capture what they've done. Kind of just an example of kind of as an integrator point of view, we found it pretty reasonable to encase activities inside of .NET, or in this case C#, to put legacy code inside of C# activities. It's not always the easiest thing in the world, but it was pretty straightforward. You can kind of capture almost anything that way. So if you are trying to integrate, we did find that as far as legacy code, it's pretty reasonable. There's the issues with things like MATLAB, which will require some more work. But for things like we encase Python, and there are different versions of Python, or different, there's a lot of things you can do in Python that will encapsulate what you need to do in MATLAB. So I just want to show the scope of things that kind of, we think we've done a pretty good job of capturing a first cut at what they need using Trident. We've been pretty pleased with it there. Going from there, the next big problem was being cross-platform. And this was hinted at earlier. So the issue was that we, not only could we rely on people having Windows systems on their desk, we were sure to run into people that if they knew they were running on a Windows platform, they were going to be upset. So we wanted to encase it inside of tools that they're used to, inside of operating systems that they're used to. And so all the stuff you just saw, actually let's show it this way first. Come on. And okay, so we worked with Microsoft to actually take, so they have a set of tools right now, an entire platform that you can do all your editing on. They also have a web service that's very full functional. You can basically write your own UI with it. Unfortunately, it's still very .NET centric. So you're going to end up having to write to .NET or do a lot of, possibly you could find a porting environment somewhere. But it's still a bit of work to actually get to it from other platforms. So we worked with them to do is a much smaller, the simple version of the web service that includes these functions. And so you can do all your basic manipulation. What it doesn't have right now, and we'll be looking at it more in the future, is things like being able to change workflows. Not that I'm thinking about creating an entire editing environment on the Mac, but more like if I want to tweak something, how do I get it back up there? But you can get your workflows, you can get your jobs, you can get your nodes, you can start them, you can stop them. So once that's in place, and it's pretty easy to write an interface that can go cross-platform. So this app that I'm showing you is white right now, but it'll be better. Come on. The reason that we're kind of, both of us were pretty slow, is that basically you've got the entire workflow service, you've got our applications, you know, all these things are fighting. In this case, I only have a single core. So here we've got an entire list of all the jobs that are sitting there that I have access to. I can log in either as securely or go in anonymously, which is this list. I can filter it in different ways to get the ones that only the ones that have completed, only ones that are active, nothing running right now, over a time frame. So quickly kind of look at, get it down to the set of jobs that I know they're there, that I'm interested in. And then as I can start new workflows that are already up there, can go through that process. I'm going to skip it because it's going to be a little slow. For ones that have completed, I can get the data for those. This is also polling the workflow service on a regular basis. So depending on the rate I want it, get it every minute, get new information about what's going on. Okay, so we'll do, in this case, see what the output for that is. So this is a workflow that basically took a model, filtered it down, and got it down to a couple variables. So quickly grab that. We'll save it out to that file. And now this will take a little while as it kind of thrashes the CPU back and forth. But I just wanted to show you that's pretty easy to go out, have something that's registered in the system as a data product from a workflow, be able to bring it into another application, be able to bring it up and display it. Any questions while we wait? Probably be another 20 seconds. It is. In my past life, I did systems building, so it's a pretty usable system. But the basis of it is the idea that I'm a researcher trying to test ideas and usability ideas with users.
So we have the National Oceanography Centre in Southampton.
What?
We have the UK National Oceanography Centre in Southampton, and we run the UK Deep Submersible Service.
Okay.
As Carol said,
Please. I'm working with, okay, so we finally got back. I can either add or update a data set. In this case, I'll add one. Close that. And after running a workflow on Trident from any platform, well, at least any platform this runs on, which is Mac and Windows, and then I can quickly, let's just get the timeline right. And you can see that brought it in. Basically, it got it down to one surface so that people could quickly work with it. As far as the question about this being available to people, I would love to get more users. And I think a lot of it has been trying to make sure I service the people that I'm working with and get it in place there before I go further and possibly have something vastly wrong. But yes, I would love to have, if you know people I'd be interested, please let me know. okay, so that.
Sorry to ask a question. How do you handle the intermediate results? So, you've got a quite complex different set of things that you're doing there. Mm-hmm. Are you able to get hold of intermediate results so that when you stop and start the workflow, you can restart it halfway through, that kind of thing?
Not right now. I would love to. Let's go back to. We had this discussion and we tabled it for the first round. But basically, I'd love another column over here, which is details, and where you can start it, stop it, know where you're at, know how far something is. Because, yeah, it's very easy to get stuck.
You might think, actually, it's going the wrong direction.
Yes.
I know, for example, that Southampton, they do a lot of steering, and because they do a lot of optimization type function stuff. Yeah. And they want to say, guys, this is all going horribly wrong, bail out, and waste another load of cycles.
Yes. And to the level Trident has it, we can get to it. It's not there quite yet.
Can you do pause, roll back, and restart? So can you, you're starting a calculation, you get halfway through, you realize it's going wrong, roll back a couple of activities, change a parameter, then roll forwards and branch a running workflow.
That's where you need to talk to Dean.
Apparently, we don't have that capability. Because some of the workflows might take 5 days, and at day three, you might not want to get, well, go all the way back to day one and start again, but start from, yeah, that's definitely in our roadmap, is it? Yes. Is it quite high on the list?
Actually, the workflow engine team, they are coming up with a new version of Windows Workflow. The Workflow 4.0.
Yeah.
We're using 3.5.
Okay.
The 4.0 supports that.
Oh, okay.
It's a matter of how we leverage that.
Sure, yeah. It's coming in the baseline.
Yeah,
and actually, just kind of from the other perspective, I'm watching it go over time. It's really important if needs exist to get them to Dean, because actually the way it works is Dean then goes back to the workflow team and gets them to add them. And until they get them at kind of the core service, it's kind of hard for his team to kind of put them in. The other point here is, as well as being able to stop it, what's missing right now is being able to set parameters at this level and put them in. Yes. And that, yes, we had a battle over that, and I lost that one in this first round. But I think there's pretty reasonable ways to do it, and that will be showing up sometime soon. Yeah, and the goal here is to get it to the point where you're not authoring a workflow necessarily, but you are giving it input and you are interacting with it. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know, you're not the expert workflow builder, somebody else will develop for you.
Yep.
But you're not the just push a big red button, some miracle occurs guy either. What you want to do is to do the kind of in between your Sunday driver who takes the car out from the bit who feels about.
Mm-hmm.
You just want to change a few things, change the parameters, maybe stop and start it a little bit, maybe you just slot in
and when you're done, at least the seat is set right and
exactly. So
near where you're going. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so one of the things that we did get that feedback to Dean's team, and there is a way to roll up parameters now for a workflow, so you can collect those in one place, make that easier to get to. So the process, the things are in place for us to go that next step, and then, okay, how do we actually kind of create a nice interface for getting this back and forth? Okay, so then I just wanted to show one more thing, and that was... Okay, we're going to do this one. Okay, so the third factor that we needed was somehow moving the visualization to the data as opposed to bringing the data locally. So the last thing you saw was, at least in the current version, is all about bringing the data locally. And let's look at this baby. Okay. So, bunch of stuff. The basic idea is once you've kind of know what you want to do with or create a visualization inside of Cove, so you've kind of come up with a view, you like what you're looking at, you want a movie of this set of data. So you brought some of it locally, now you want to move it up to the server and have it live there. So we basically added the capability to Cove to act as an activity. So you can actually send things to that and treat it as a service that you then wait for results from and bring it back. So in this case, let's start it off. It'll take a little while to get going. But the idea is on any workflow, and we hope to make this more seamless as time goes forward, you can basically have your data out there, you're bringing workflows, you're bringing your data locally, you're living with it, but it's painful. You get the things you want to look at, and that's basically what our scientists, what we ended up seeing, is that they would end up with a page of visualizations that they wanted to look at every day. Have we started? There we are. Okay, so what we want to do is create that same capability where once you've come up with a bunch of things in Cove that you like, put it up on the server. Okay, now we're going to do the cooking show trick, and we'll just stop that. And at the end of all that, as you step it all through, you're going to go run Cove as a process to create a movie. And yes, yes, yes. think that was clear. There we go. Oh, stop it. Go away. So the point being, besides making it easy to, a lot easier to get some visualizations, it solves this huge problem of I'm on the road. I'm now on any kind of device anywhere. I can get something that's small and portable, and also something that I can easily share with my colleagues, as well as bringing the data locally and having the size problem. We found that scientists don't like to share their data. Giving someone else access to their data is a big deal. Giving a visualization is a very safe way in order to share ideas, have a conversation. And so we're working very hard to make visualization kind of the endpoint in this system and use that as kind of a way of communication for the scientists as opposed to passing data around or making access to other data. There will be small groups that want to do that, but for the masses, it seems like this is a much more feasible approach. Okay, any more questions? Thanks a lot. Appreciate your time.
Okay, I'm going to get started. So now you see a couple of demos, a couple of use case scenarios. I'm going to dive deeper in terms of technical details. If you have any questions, please feel free to ask. I want to make this as interactive as possible. Again, these are the Trident features. I'm going to quickly go through it because I'm going to do a demo. It has a libraries of activities and workflows. When you see the designer surface on the left-hand side, that's the catalog of activities and workflows. And workflow versioning, access control, so we support security. And you can have different roles. You can either edit the workflow or you run the workflow only. And we have workflow packages, so you can export workflow packages and then export it to my experiment, or you can share with other researchers. This is the logical architecture of Trident. Start from the left-hand side is the designer. That's the workbench. That's where you visually design workflows. Again, that builds on top of Windows Workflow Foundation. It supports workflow packages. That's where you can export a workflow as a package. And everything that's needed to run the workflow is within that package. And so you can, it's self-contained. If you give that workflow package to another Trident user, that can be imported and then can be reproduced, can be rerun. We have a management studio. That's where you can monitor workflows. You can start, stop workflows. And also has a registry management. What that means is you can manage workflows, activities, all the runtime libraries. You can delete, you can recreate. Of course, a community site. So this allows users to export workflows to the My Experiment website. And that we find this is critically important because My Experiment really provides the not just sharing but also provides the mechanism for curation. So users can provide comments and see whether this workflow works or this workflow doesn't work. Runtime services, we added additional services on top of Windows Workflow on runtime. For example, has leveraging HPC scheduling service, have a provenance service. It uses publish and subscribe mechanism. So there's a blackboard where the runtime publishes data to the blackboard, and there are different subscribers. For example, the monitoring module subscribes the data and puts the data into the monitoring. and Provenance Service does the same thing. And you can write your own services. I say you don't really like the granularity of the provenance capturing, and you can write your own provenance service, and then you capture your own provenance data. So we have a Trident registry. That's where all the data is stored. And for example, all the workflow binary, the inputs, outputs, all the connections among activities. So everything is stored in the registry. And so you can manage the versioning, and you can, all the export import is all through this registry. And right now we have the SQL Server support. Of course, this architecture has this data agnostic abstraction layer so that we can easily plug in other data storage technologies. For example, the SQL Server Data Services, that's the cloud version of SQL Server, and Amazon M3, and others. So this is like a little complicated. So on the left-hand side, you see there are different applications, the Management Studio, the Composer, that's the workflow composer. And the workflow application is an application that's where you run the workflow. For example, as a user, you use the workflow composer to build a workflow, and you can give this to somebody else, and that user may not be interested in building a workflow, it's just to run the workflow. Just like Carol was saying, they just want to tweak different parameters and see how it runs. So we created a workflow application for that purposes. Of course, we have a serverless support. So we realize that users, they're different kinds of users, the Mac users, Linux users, and of course Windows users. And we have the serverless application so that it can run across different platforms. And then there's a web service support. Keith demonstrated, we use that web service to interface with Trident runtime so that you can run workflows. Currently, we don't support authoring workflows across platform yet, but at least after you build a workflow, you can run the workflow from other platforms, from Mac, from Linux. And let me just give you an example how it works internally. Starting from the composer. So the workflow composer you saw, there's a designer surface, you build a workflow, you visually drag and drop activities, you connect them together, you save as a workflow. Let's say you say run. When it runs, first thing it creates a job in the registry. So the registry stores the job. And then there's the execution service. So the execution service picks up that job. So it's asynchronous. There's the composer doesn't need to wait for the execution service to complete. And the execution service picks up the job. First thing is publishes the data to the blackboard. So the blackboard is a publish and subscribe mechanism. And it takes the data. And there are different subscribers in the system. The different subscribers, they all subscribe this blackboard. And if you want to have additional service, you can add it, and then you subscribe the blackboard, and then you get the data as other services. So the provenance subscribes the data, and the composer also is a subscriber of the data. So when you saw when the workflow was running, the monitoring, the data you saw, that's published from the blackboard. So that completes the data flow. And this is how it works in the high-performance clustering environment. So it's very similar to the desktop environment. The difference is in a high-performance cluster, there's a head node. That head node knows everything about the compute nodes. All the calculations are done in compute nodes. So we have the head node. The head node has the execution service that's responsible for getting the job. And then we have an interface to the HPC cluster scheduler. So we tell the HPC scheduler, we're saying, okay, now we have some workflow jobs for you to process. And the HPC scheduler knows which node in this cluster is the best for processing the workflow. No, it's using the scheduler, directly interfacing with the scheduler. And the scheduler knows about which node is available. Right, right. Any other questions before I move on? And some users actually want to have more granular control. For example, you may want to dedicate a couple of nodes to process some data-intensive workflows. That's possible as well. So you can customize the execution service and make your own kind of a scheduling algorithm. And you can make, you can say, okay, I want to allocate these nodes to process these workflows. Again, this is the brief introduction about Windows Workflow. We're using Windows Workflow 3.5. 4.0 is beta 2. It's going to come out soon. I don't know the detailed date. I think by next year it should be in production. And the Workflow Foundation provides the runtime. So we don't need to write a runtime ourselves. We added the necessary services on top of that. And the, out of the box, there are built-in activities. So we can leverage those. Of course, you can add custom activities. In the designer, these are all custom activities, but we inherit the existing capabilities of workflow, and then we can easily customize what's in there. The answer is yes and no. So in the installer, there are different options. It's not like the whole package. The whole package is not. There's different options. You can say, okay, I want to install the composer only. Of course, the composer needs the runtime. So there's some interconnections. And there's a management studio piece. And So it's a select. You have some options to choose. So the tooling part, out of the Windows Workflow Foundation, you can look at it, is really a set of libraries. It's a framework. Visual Studio is the default environment where you develop Windows workflows, but we find that it's really intimidating for researchers and scientists to use Visual Studio. That's why we develop a custom designer, the workflow designer. So it's a data flow centric, and it's really easy of use. So there's little programming experience required to use that environment. So you can see the we really use the Windows Workflow Foundation library to build this rehosted designer.
So is the attachment
Yeah, so we support this multi-user environment. The registry is a central data store, so that can be accessed by multiple users. So when you install Trident system, you have dedicated registry, and then you can install the client in multiple computers. They all access the same registry, so you can share workflows, and that way have multiple user support.
Is the registry SQL server-based?
Yeah, currently it's a SQL server-based. But again, we have this mechanism, the data abstraction layer, so you can customize it and support different database technologies. And we are moving towards to see the cloud storage. So of course, we use the same abstraction layer. If you want to use Oracle, it's doable, but may take a while, but it's doable. Again, this is the workflow. This is the flow, how we see you build the workflow activities. You can use out-of-the-box activities. That's the baseline. And a lot of times, you may not find that meet your needs. So you would develop this custom activities. And after you develop those activity libraries, you can build workflow packages. And you can have astronomy-related workflow packages, the biology-related, oceanography-related. Actually, this afternoon, there will be a session, Microsoft Biology Foundation. There's a set of libraries. We're working closely with this domain so that you can build libraries of gene alignment algorithms. They're all part of the library catalog, and you can easily build our workflows on top of that. Again, I'm going to quickly go through it because I will do a demo. The programming interface to Trident is first you use Visual Studio, develop custom activities. So you write the code, and then after that you import to Trident. From there, with the workflow composer, you can drag and drop activities and build new workflows. Yes, so let's say typical scenarios, you develop a activity, you build a workflow, now you modify the activity, and then you import it again. We create a new version. Once you import the activity, we automatically create a new version for you. So we don't delete the previous activity because that activity might be used by other workflows. If we overwrite that activity, then the previous workflow will be impacted. So we do have the version support for activity level, also the workflow level. Let's say you have a workflow and you modify that workflow and then you save it, we actually create a new version for that because we don't want to eliminate the previous one.
So you said earlier that the activities, some of them could be like web services, I think.
Yes. Dynamic.
Yes, they adventurously change their, okay. Their interfaces and behavior on a routine basis. But you don't have control over them.
So we don't.
What do you do with third party web services and your workflows that are in constant churn?
Yeah, it's a challenge. Right now, what we do is I will show you how we wrap services. As an activity, so we have a wizard. So you put a web service WSDL file, and then we create a activity around that. But if that web service changes, then we have a problem. So you may have to create another one, or during runtime is going to fail. But we don't know, we don't have a mechanism to detect they have changed. Yeah, yeah. So this is a little technical. Some of you might be interested in this because I got questions about how you get this, the activity displayed on the designer surface. You see the inputs and output. Like something like this, so these are the steps how to create that. Again, it's in the handout, so you don't need to write them down. So basically, you use Visual Studio, you create a project, you reference a Triton library, you implement, you declare the inputs and outputs, and then you implement a execute method. So there, it's a template. You put your code in a specific place, and then you compile this as a DLL, we call it assembly, and then you import it to Triton. Once you import to Triton, Triton interprets the inputs and outputs, and on the designer surface, is going to draw each activity like this. So it has a well-defined inputs and outputs, and you can drag and drop and connect things together. Again, the execution service supports local execution runtime, and also it supports the high-performance cluster environment. It's the same experience, and I'm going to show you what it looks like. I don't have the HPC cluster here, but you'll get the point. And in the future, we're going to move to Windows Azure platform. It supports interactive and non-interactive. Again, if you use Trident, the common thing is there are two kinds of workflows. One kind of workflow is purely processing data. There's no UI involved. But there's another kind of workflow. There's a UI in the middle. You may need to enter additional data, and then you continue. We call that interactive workflow. To enable that, you can, as part of workflow property, you can say this is interactive, this is non-interactive. If it's interactive, that means it will support the UI. Otherwise, the Windows is not going to show up. Again, the Management Studio, this is where users manage workflows. You can start workflows, stop workflows, and you can also monitor how workflows run locally and remotely. This is the workflow application. It has a Serverlet version and Windows version. So you can see all this does is it provides you the workflows that you have access to. And on the right-hand side, it will present the parameters for that workflow so you can change. And then you specify where you want to run the workflow. You can run locally, and then you can run it in a cluster. So if you want to run a cluster, you just select the head node of the cluster. And then we capture who is running that. And after that, you say execute. It's going to submit a job, and it's going to run. And you see the data outputs from here. Again, this is my experiment. This is how it looks like. After you export, we have my experiment site has a set of web services, so we leverage those web services directly, and we, as a user, you sign up my experiment, you become a user of my experiment, and then in Trident Management Studio, you just type your username and password. So we directly call the web services provided by experiment, and the workflows can be uploaded there. And then you can, other people can download from there. So I'm going to start demos from here. So you're looking at the workflow designer. You saw the demo before. On the left-hand side, this is the workflow library. Again, you can have different categories. If you want to create a new category, you just right mouse click a category, so you can create a subcategory. So as a user, you have the control how you want to arrange different workflows. And this is the activity catalog. Again, there are different activities out of the box. And if you develop custom activities, you can import it to Trident, and those custom activities will show up here. And this is a designer surface. This is where you can create a new workflow, and then you drag and drop different activities, and you connect them together. We have a monitor window. This is where, when you run a workflow, you see at each step what's happening. So all these messages are from the Blackboard. So the execution service publishes the data to the Blackboard, and the workflow composer is a subscriber of that Blackboard. And we also have provenance. So this is where you can see what's going on at each step. So I'm going to show you how it works. So I'm going to start from nothing. So let's say I'm a Trident user. I just installed Trident. I want to develop my own activity, and I want to create a workflow from that custom activity. First thing I do is I create a project using a Visual Studio. I already created this. This is a very simple activity. I just want to show how it works. So there are two inputs, and input one and input two. These are all strings. And there's only one output. So the output is going to combine the inputs and concatenate them. This is how it looks like as input parameter. So you declare this is the input, and what's the name of the input? This is the input two, and this is the output. And there's the execute method. This is where you can customize how you want the activity, what the activity should do. Again, you can evoke existing program. You can access to a database. You can, let's say, call a program in Linux. Once we figure out the exact mechanism, this is where all the actions happen. Once you implement that, you compile it, and then you compile it a DLL, which I already did. I'm ready to import to Trident environment. So what I need to do is I say import activity. I browse to that DLL location, which is workshop, demo, hello world. So you choose the assembly that you want to import. And there are different options, whether you want to update. Or because this is new, I don't need to do any update. I say import. All the status is going to show here, the lower left corner. So it's successfully imported. And it's going to go to the uncategorized as part of the activity library. You see the Hello World example is here. Now, I would say I want to create a new workflow. So I can just drag and drop this activity into the designer. Again, when you import it, we interpret, the Trident interprets what's the input, what's the output, and then it draws that, a box for you. I say I want to assign this value as hello. World. Now I want to save this. I give a name of the workflow. Again, this is where I can say whether that's interactive or non-interactive. In this case, I don't have any UI. It doesn't matter. I just give it interactive. You can pick which category you want this workflow to be at. Make it my workflow, because I'm still developing this. And these are the parameters. So now I'm done with this workflow. Let me run this workflow. Once it runs, workflow is launched. So the job is created. And that's, it's saving the registry. Execution service picks that up. And then they publish it to the Blackboard. And this is the subscriber of the Blackboard. Soon, it's going to display what data comes out from the Blackboard. It runs at, because I'm using, at this time I'm using the one is logging to the system. Because we use the login user as a default. Yes, so there is a registry component. So this is the registry tool. This is where you can give assigned access to different workflows. Because I installed Trident on my computer, by default, I'm the admin. I have access to all the workflows. From here, you can pick a workflow. And there's a permission. So this is where you can add additional users. And then you say, OK, I want anonymous users to access. That means usually if you have a web service support, that web service is run as anonymous. And then you can say whether you have an author workflow access or run workflow access. Yes, that will have the yes, on the back end it will be Active Directory.
So if you're not running it interactively though, we've just run into a lot of trouble with multi-hop authentication and issues of trying to access SQL Server or other resources, you know, on remote machines. And I'm just some things you want to run interactively, you run during this application, but sometimes you want to run something and just have it be going for a while.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so in this case, we have this anonymous user. That's where we use, because as a web service, a lot of times you want to support, the web server itself runs as a network service identity. And so we create this anonymous user to accommodate that. Of course, you can manage your access within activity. You can log in, but that's kind of tedious work to make it happen. But again, there's... Yeah.
I hope that that's part of the vision for this is having authentication not being an impediment.
Yes. The first step is we at least allow a network service account to run the workflow, so you don't need to configure, because if you use network service account, we make it anonymous from there. And from there, you can see input and output at each step. You can see the hello. The output is hello world. And during runtime, because it's so fast, but we keep track of CPU utilization and memory. And this is specific to this workflow. And if you use a performance monitor, you don't see this kind of a granular detail. And a lot of times, users really want to know what's the performance characteristics of this workflow. And this provides that information. And let me add a new activity. And as I will make this workflow more interesting. So this is the base. You import the activity, you build a workflow, you run it, now it works. Let me make this a little more interesting. Let me just drag and drop this again. So I'm going to build a new workflow, and I'm going to connect the output of the first activity to the second one. So if I say hello world, the output will be hello world, and then input two. Okay, so I'm going to say hello world, everyone. And then I will save this workflow. And this time I'm going to say, for this workflow, I only need two inputs. So you can mark a input parameter as a workflow input. So these are the parameters. When you run the workflow application, you can change it so that you can explore different outputs by running different combinations. And this is the way how you do that. You mark a specific input. You say these are the inputs for this workflow. Let me just mark this as a workflow input as well. So I can tweak three parameters to run this workflow. Now I save it. And I can actually save this as a workflow link. And again, coming down to a multi-user environment, I say I'm an author. I build a workflow. I can save this as a link. And I can give this link to another user. And another user can open this link and then run the workflow. Yeah. And they all access the central store. Yes, you need a Trident client to do that. So I can store this as a link on my desktop. Let me run it here to make sure it works the way I really want it to be. This is where when you run the workflow application, so you can see these are the workflow inputs, and then you can change different different combinations. So let's say you run different parameters, you like have a parameter sweep, and you can experiment. Yeah, because you may have 10 inputs. Let's say you have a complex workflow. There are many inputs parameters available. And we don't want to present everything to the user. and you can control which parameters they can tweak. And the other parameter can be defaults. So that you provide that limited set, and then users can do the experiment. They see, the users see, yeah. And the other inputs, they don't, yeah. So that provides you a kind of a control. When you design the workflow, you control, okay, what parameters that you want the actual user to see. So I'm done with this workflow, and I can look at the provenance. So we talk about, okay, automatic capture of provenance information. This is how the provenance looks like. We capture what the workflow name, when was run, who ran it, and we know, okay, what's the inputs, what are the outputs. And the detailed information provides you all the details at different steps. For example, we capture the workflow itself, and let's say you change the workflow, this will not impact this part of it. When we record the provenance, we record the workflow that was used, and who ran it, when was run. And at each step, you can see what happened. So the first step, their inputs, hello world, and the output is hello world. And then the second step, you can see the everyone, hello world, and hello world, everyone. So you see every step, what the result, and this is very important for reproducible research, and you want to validate, you want to compare different workflows, how they run, and you can go back and compare them. And then we also maintain the version history. As yeah, I changed this 3 times. Yeah.
But is there a way of being able to actually wire together the relationship between inputs and the outputs? Because often when using services, there isn't an obvious relationship between the inputs and the outputs. So can that break the data provenance trace? So is there a way of being able to incorporate that? Or do I do that in my wrapper that I build?
Yeah, you need a wrapper. Yeah. So it's in the database, in the relational format, and then you can have a wrapper to build the semantics around that.
And then that gets used by this provenance.
Yeah. And then let me go back to that workflow link. So remember, I created a workflow link. So I save this. I can send an email to my coworker and another researcher. And then if I double click on this, this will bring up the workflow application. And you can see that for this particular workflow, these are the options I have. I have the input parameters. So these are the things I can tweak. I can change input 1 and 2 or 3. And then I can choose where I want to run it. You want to run it locally, or you want to run it remotely in a cluster. And then you just say execute. That's all you need to do. And then it will create a job, and all the results will be saved in the registry. The provenance will be created, and you can go back to Management Studio to see what happened. And then if I just bring up the workflow application itself, I think I already have the... if I bring up it separately, the difference is that I see all the workflows I can access to. So if you create a link, you click on the link, that's dedicated for that workflow itself. But if you want to bring up the workflow application, you see all the workflows
you have access to, and then you can pick the workflow. Again, I see the Hello World workflow here, and I can change parameters, I can run it, and so forth. Let me close that. And one challenge for users is, let's say you develop an activity, you find that it didn't work the way you want it. It's kind of awkward. You have to go back to the Visual Studio, you debug it, and then you import it again. So based on the user feedback, we added this debugging capability. So what I did is you can run in debug mode. Assuming you have the Visual Studio installed on your computer, let me just run a debug mode. So what this allows you to do is you can bring up the actual activity, and then you can set a breakpoint and see what's happening. So this is a debug mode, and soon it's going to launch a debugger. It appears like an error, but it's not. That allows me to attach to a debugger, and then you can have option to say, okay, I want to break at that point. See, it says possible debuggers. From here, I can open oh, I need to attach to the right. I need to find the right let me attach one more time. Let me use this one. Save it. Do a sample. So from here, I have this Hello World workflow, and then I say, okay, I want to debug this activity. Workflow is launched. We do this one. Here we go. So I attached the
debugger, I set a breakpoint, and then oh, hold on. Oh, because I typed a letter there. So now let me recompile this. So this is the typical debugging session, right? So I will debug right here. Let me close everything. So let's say there's an error, and right now I'm gonna correct the error. I'm gonna debug it and make sure it goes through every step. So now it's successful. Let me just close everything. I have a new workflow. And what I'm going to do, I'm going to show you how I manage the assembly. I think this is a good place to show. Okay, I just recompile a new workflow, a new activity. I had the old activity in place, right? So there's a new, there's a activity in the assembly library. So Triton stores all the assemblies in the registry, and the registry manager shows the assemblies, the workflows, and so you can manage, you can delete, you can purge workflows. So in this case, I'm going to show you how we manage workflows in this case. I'm going to delete this workflow. So I pick the workflow. I say, I want to delete this workflow. And this is actually a soft delete because sometimes users may make mistake. To really delete the workflow, you have to do a kind of a hard delete. What that means is in the workflow manager, we have a category called the deleted workflows. Let me see, in this, I want to delete this. That. So I just delete those. And then from the workflow manager, I should be able to refresh those. And again, so when you say delete, first time the soft delete. From here, I can say purge. Purge means totally delete the workflow. You're really sure that you want to delete that. So now I clean up all the workflows. And then I can go back and say, I want to manage this activity, the assembly, the Hello World assembly. You can find here, you can say, I want to delete that too. So that's gone. And this is how you manage, let's say you develop activity, you don't really like it, you can delete it. And so let me start from scratch.
here, I just refresh it. And then I had the new activity there. So let me import one more time. So I just import it. Now I want to save it. Make it interactive. Hello world. Okay, so this is saved. Now I want to run the debug mode. Again, the workflow is launched. I say attach. Let me make sure this is the right path. You can set a breakpoint, and then you should run. So he's going to stop here. So you can see that string one is hello, string two is world. So this is how you can go back. And you do, if there's a problem with the activity, you can run this as a debug mode, and you can see what's happening along the way. And let me show you how we handle web services. So Carol was just asking how we call external web services. I have a web service implemented on my own computer. Again, this can be any web service. This web service is I call the temperature conversion. It's a Celsius Fahrenheit. It's very simple. There are really two. If you look at this web service, has two methods, either from Celsius to Fahrenheit, Fahrenheit to Celsius. I can test this. I say 37 degrees Celsius. And the web service tells me this is the Fahrenheit. And I'm going to say I want to create activity to call this web service. So what is the step to do that? Let me close everything. Let me close this as well. This is the URL for the web service. I'm going to use this to reference it when I create the activity. So we provide a wizard to import web service. This makes easier to create this. You can create it manually, but we realize that we want to make it as easy as possible. So as a user, all I need to do is to give the web service URL to here, and then you say connect. We'll interpret how many methods are in this web service.
Let's say I want to do Celsius to Fahrenheit. I click on here. We know how many input parameters are. So in this case, there's only one input parameter. We added additional parameters. We added URL because sometimes when you develop a activity, you may use the test web service URL. And when you put in the production, you want to change it to the production URL. So we added there. And if you click on next, this is the default activity name. And this is where you can pick where you want to put that, which category you want to put in. And this is where you can modify what the input parameter look like. So let's say I want to make it capitalized. Now I can do a preview. So this is the what the activity will look like when you import that web service to the designer. So we automatically generate the activity assembly, and then we can import it for you. After that, the activity will show up in the web service category. Let's say I want to build a new workflow, and I want to call that web service. So this is the activity that allows me to call that web service. Let me save this as a test. I just want to make it interactive. My workflow. Say I can give a temperature at 100 as a default. Then I say run this. So what happens is it's going to call the web service and it's going to return results to me. This is how you wrap. Again, if the web service is changed, this is going to generate an error. Yeah.
So I might talk to you later about that because we can now run the biocatalog, which is a catalog of web services in biology. And so we have to handle all sorts of kinds of web services, like rest-like services, as well as a vanilla kind of whistle. What you find in biology, at least, is that there are an enormous number of very important services, the MBOS ones, gene pattern line theory, but actually the WSDL is four methods. Get it, check it, put, that's it. And then all of the services are identical, so you get the effect of just those four methods. Because they're actually wrapped themselves. And so that's a real dog. So if we're writing all those RIPers already, maybe we should share the RIPers with you.
Sure. So any questions so far?
So the actual runtime engine for the workflows, I guess the model is you have a central one, and then you might have local ones you can run.
The engine is a one, and so you can look at the engine as a state machine. So workflows consist of different activities. So during runtime, it goes each activity. So really there are two deployment modes, right? There's a local deployment mode. There's a service mode. So we have a web service available that allows you to take advantage of the server deployment. And on the client side, you submit jobs. All the execution will run on the server side. not on the client side. So in that case. Yeah, yeah. So the assumption is they all connect to the same registry. So they all go to the central store to give the status. But each station, let's say in the clustering environment, each machine has its own workflow engine. But they all run, they can run parallel. So they can run parallel. So we have a few minutes. Let me go through the last slide to talk about future directions. And then we can go through some additional question and answers. So future directions, this year our job is to support the community. Because we're about to release Trident version 1. Our focus really is to help to build a Trident community, collaborate with other teams. We really want to make this as a community tool. And we believe that innovation come from sharing, come from open source. So one thing we're working on is to enable a Trident source available to the community. And we also are exploring different scenarios. For example, astronomy is one, oceanography, of course, bioinformatics. We're going to publish samples, reference implementations. And also, we want to leverage Windows Azure, the cloud platform. We want to run workflows on the cloud, and I believe that will add value for sharing and also add the scalability for workflow. And again, Yan was mentioning the Dryad link. Again, this is the Microsoft Research technology that where you can do parallel program against different computers. You program sequentially, but it runs in parallel. So it makes it easy to manage multiple nodes. And we're also looking at upgrading our workflow application to Silverlight, the latest Silverlight release. When we developed a Trident system, that was Silverlight 2.0. Right now there's the Silverlight 3.0. We want to take advantage of that. So users can run workflows from Linux, Mac, and Windows. And we also are looking at the new innovation in the .NET 4.0 and see whether we can enable the smart reruns, all these new features. Yeah.
So actually, once it's there, you're good to go. But actually, moving things in and
yeah.
out. So, how are you planning to do that in your workflows? Are you planning that all the data gets shoved into the cloud and then you run the workflow over the cloud? Or are you planning for a hybrid where some of it's local and some of it's in the cloud and then you have to do this within workflow upload? Or, I'm interested in any ideas.
These are the things we're exploring. Actually, Trey, she was an intern, Trey Ling. She's from Wayne State University. She did an intern. She studied how the possibilities, how we leverage the cloud services. Yeah, there are a lot of issues, like large data sets, how we move data to the cloud. That itself takes a long time. And are we going to support like a ship a tape, ship a disk, and then load, and so these are all things we need. I don't know the answer for these. These are all the things that we need to explore. That's why we are actively exploring different ways of enabling workflows to run on the cloud. But definitely there are a lot of interest in this area.
We have a question.
Oh, pardon me?
Oh,
I don't. I think there are two things. One is if it's a strong enough demand, we'll speed up the research activity. Yeah, if you push us hard, we work hard. And it really depends on how much demand. And of course, we are collaborating with the another research. Actually, Roger is heading that team, and we're collaborating with their team and try to figure out what's the best way to do that.
I know that Amazon are moving towards this virtual kind of project networks in the cloud, so you can control where your data goes in the cloud. Will Azure be doing that as well? Because that's a real problem with scientific data. Like in the UK, we're not allowed to put our data into the cloud if we cannot guarantee it will remain in Europe. On an American machine, because then it's subject to the Patriots Act. And so that means we have to control the territory. Now, Amazon are beginning to put in place abilities to be able to control the territory. Will Azure be doing that as well? Because that's very important for the workflow, because you're running this workflow, and this data is going somewhere.
As
soon as it moves onto a US machine, it becomes, you know, a problem.
Yeah, I think it's involved policy issues and technology issues.
Political issues.
Yes. So it's complicated. I don't know the answer. I think that's something that these are exactly the issues we need to resolve. Running a workflow on the cloud is easy to say, but it's actually more difficult to do it.
So that it doesn't hit these law issues, and it has a lot of skilled people, and it has natural cooling, and it has energy resources. So it's a place where he would recommend people build their data centers.
Except for the earthquake,
Yeah, he said the earthquake is a slight issue. Yeah, and then they have it in California, right? So it works.
So now we're introducing weather, the location specific issues, the earthquake, and in addition to political issues.
Okay.
Any other questions?
Can you wrap it to this call and executable, something that you've already written and compiled?
Yes. Actually, the workflow Yan showed you, it calls the executable.
Create hosters, worldwide telescope, they are all applications developed
independently. They are not knowing each other's existence, and they just spend a lot of applications. So we have an actively Trident launcher, command line launcher. Uh-huh. So as long as you can run those activities, I mean those applications at a command line, okay, we can launch them with the parameters that we have required.
Oh, so you can pass parameters?
Yeah. Just one like that. What I'm working, currently working on is that if you have an application on Linux, I'm trying to call directly across.
You can't wrap anything as UI. I tried that recently. The problem is you're inside of a service, and there's a lot of restrictions once you get inside of the Trident service. And
right. It may require, like I had an arrow box, window arrow, message box, then I need to click OK, and then I have to get on the workflow. So we may need to do a lot of just changes to the original program to see if we want to select requirements. But that's what's available.
Yeah, basically you can run it in a batch mode.
You can do, let me repeat the question. So the question is whether you can do everything I can do on the designer,
yeah,
and with command line. The answer is no.
Running
workflow is yes. You can manage workflow. You can start workflows, stop workflows, run workflows, pass parameters. But the tricky thing is. How you manage those, add activity to the designer, connect things together, these things are not.
It's all in Zoml.
Yes.
So you could do it through Zoml.
Yes.
To the minimum, you can use Trident as just chain up everything that you would do one after another manually. But then as a good engineering practice, if you do have different applications, you want to make sure all those applications are developed using XML as the metadata.
Suppose I want to collaborate with you.
Yeah.
Can we do a loosely coupled workflow? So you make one and that ends up pushing to that Blackboard, and then I have a subscription. My workflow subscribes to the Blackboard. It sees data show up and then it says, oh, I can run it.
It's possible. It's possible that you subscribe. The Blackboard service, the subscriber, the publisher, they all based on Windows Communication Foundation. So it's possible that you have a subscriber, you register as a subscriber, and during the runtime you get what data that execution service publishes, and then you interpret the data. That's how we design it. So
yeah,
so you capture the events that workflow engine provides.
You could actually use the Blackboard here as an interoperability mechanism.
Yeah, I think that's a great point. Yes. Yes. Yeah.
So I end up doing all these shims in order to be able to massage data between one service and another, and they get very, and you end up with very untidy workflows.
Mm-hmm.
So can I use your wrapper system to sort of wrap these things into bigger components? Not just take the service as it is, but take the service and add another lot of stuff onto it and then wrap that up as one component and then put that in my workflow. You see what I mean?
Yeah, so the wizard right now is very kind of rudimentary.
Thin.
Yeah, thin. So there will be some manual work. It's possible to do this. It's possible, but I think at this point it will involve the manual programming. Yeah, so the in order to have a visitor like that, we need to improve, we need to make it more robust. But it's possible to do with what you're... Yes. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, so if we, I think the idea is we want to build a catalog of these shims, and then out of the box, we want to support as many of these as possible. And so you can reuse those.
But we just built one.
Yeah, so we can, yeah. We definitely want to, yes, we can definitely. Could you repeat this again?
What did you mean by data will be a first class?
Oh yeah, so this is related to how we want to provide the platform. We want to allow users to easily define the inputs and outputs. A lot of times a scientific workflow involves data collection, data analysis, you run different models, and then you have visualization. And each step usually has a data input and output, whether it's a large data set, small data set. So we want to make it natural for the user to think that way, because that's how a lot of scientific experiments are done. So when we design a system, we look at that and we want to make sure in our designer, when you run things, we support that kind of mechanism. So for example, in the designer, you see each activity has the well-defined inputs and outputs. And it's just like other workflow systems that we want to make sure it's natural for scientists to use. And then you have this well-defined in and out, and then you can connect the previous out to the next in, and things like that. And another picture is we want to manage the data sets in a registry. Right? So a data set, just like other programs, you need to manage. Once it gets large, you need to keep track of them. Yes, it does. Let's say you connect two different data types during a runtime, would generate an error saying you cannot do that.
Are these scalar data types, or are they logical application-specific data types?
You define, as a user, you can define your own data types. And then during the runtime, we look at the hierarchy. So let's say you have parent, you have child, and then we look at the hierarchy as well. And let's say you have the parent, and then there's a child, and then we allow you to do that because the child has all the attributes the parent has. And so we check at that level. Again, it's not just simple data types. You can have complex data types. Again, it's part of the activity. You define, you declare, those are the data types that I use. When you import activity, we know, okay, you have these data types. Okay, thank you very much.